Yes, going through your financial report, the good news, yes, is that you've got no financial worries at all. Will you be making the same charity donation again this year? $200,000, yes?
Yes.
Yes. Same recipient, the trust, yes?
Yes.
Yes, and from the same bank account, the Montana Union Credit Bank, yeah? Yes. As per your employment agreement, Damocles will be matching your pension contributions, which have been substantial. You have put away the maximum, and the company plan has seen it grow at a rate of a good 6% per year. You can draw half of that on your official retirement date, which is in
14 days.
Yes. Then in 14 days, Damocles will be cutting you a check for the best part of $8,207,523.04. How about that, Mr. Vizla?
We interrupt this program to bring you a special report.
This is Cheapseat Reviews.
Hello. Oh, sorry. I don't know why I was expecting somebody to answer. Hello. Thank you for listening to Cheap Seat Reviews, the podcast that explores the Hollywood film industry for the greater good.
The greater good.
This is episode something. I don't have my script in front of me.
132.
242.
Oh, I'm a little off.
Yeah, just a few. And tonight we're talking about the Netflix original movie, Polar.
Express?
Not the Polar Express. Just,
oh,
just,
crap. Really?
Just Polar. Yeah. Oh. No, that would be a very different movie than this one, both in tone and even just the fact that it was made
rating.
With real people and rating and nudity. I am Sean Allred, and joining me tonight is Andrew Never Scratch Your Head with Laser Gloves Jimison.
Good afternoon, good evening, and good night.
And also joining us is Sam, who also assassinates people naked in the snow Vector.
Absolutely. Now, Sean, hold on. Hold very still while I point at you.
Oh, okay. And in the whole wide range of ways people die in this movie, I was wondering where you were going to go with that.
Yes. Or how about the axe under the bed?
Axe to the face from the bed was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was pretty good. Or, okay, well, we'll get into it. let's pull up a comfy chair and dive into this movie, Polar. It's a 2019 movie called Polar. And
oh, I didn't realize it was that recent.
Yeah, it just came out.
Okay.
Like, I mean, I remember doing an episode probably 3 or 4 weeks ago.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, while I was on IMDb, all the... these advertisements for this movie kept popping up. Netflix, you know, original Polar, starring Mads Mikkelsen and some other people. And I was like, oh, this actually looks interesting. And some other people that I know watched it and said, oh, you got to do this for the podcast. I really want to know what you guys think. And I'm like, okay, well, sure, why not? We'll do it for the show. So this is our second in a row Netflix movie we've done. Though Mowgli last week was tonally very different than The Jungle Book, this movie is significantly farther
it's about the same.
Down the tracks of
very
the rating.
Disney-like.
Yeah. So we completely forgot last week, so we're not going to do it this week. Andrew, please give us the lowdown. What is this movie, Polar, that Netflix made with the guy from... The guy that tortured Daniel Craig by hitting him in the balls.
All right. the world's top assassin, Duncan Vizla?
Vizla
is settling into retirement when his former employer marks him as a liability to the firm. Against his will, he finds himself back in the game, going head to head with an army of younger killers. So, in essence, it's what we all face when somebody younger with, you know, a little more tech savvy takes a job that you have, and then you want to strangle them because they think they know everything, and then you watch them fail and laugh.
That's very oddly specific. That's true. But yeah, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of like, isn't this kind of how the state of North Carolina treats its teachers?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess. Yeah, the state's like, oh, you are getting close to retirement age and we owe you a lot of money. It's time to die. I don't think that reads very correct.
No, that's accurate.
No. He's not a liability to the firm. He's going to retire and go hide. He's not a liability.
He's not the I mean, they kind of ruined part of the story.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were still talking about teachers.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, this is a how they're saving money type of deal, right?
Yeah, it's okay. It's been a while since I've gotten to play this clip, and I have to look for it while I talk. But basically, the whole point of the movie, right? So, like, John Wick gets back into the fold because this dude shows up and kills his dog.
Yeah,
and it's just a pure and simple
revenge flick.
Revenge movie. That's all it is.
I swear, if you kill my dog.
Yeah, I mean, they killed his dog, and he's mad, and he wants his revenge on that, and we kind of get that. And then the second movie, he gets brought back in for a very different reason, but for all intents and purposes,
still haven't seen that second movie.
Well, it's all right. It's not as good as the first, but it's pretty entertaining. But you know, he gets brought back in for completely different reasons. Whereas in this movie, I'm just going to go ahead and play this.
Not a great plan.
The bad guy. apparently, you know, this company that's been around for a long time, this Damocles, right? And then we have to assume that weird dude that's in charge of it, that played Tweedledee and Tweedledum in the freaking Alice in Wonderland movies. this one was Tweedle stupid. I guess his father started this assassination company.
Or the father before his father, or somewhere.
Or whatever.
Yeah.
Whatever. It's an old company, and for whatever reason, he's ready to retire it. He's ready to sell off to the men in black. And but in order to do so, he needs to prove that they have income. And so in doing so, if he kills all these dudes that are about to retire, their pensions fall back to the company, therefore generating revenue. I mean, that's the point. And it seems kind of dumb.
Yeah, especially when you're dealing with killers.
And the woman Vivian, who we know from Vikings, who is hot, I guess I'm just going to go ahead and say it.
Wait. Which one was she?
She was Vivian. She was the one that kept saying, "Just pay him the money and he'll go away."
Oh, okay, yeah.
She's from Vikings, which is a really good show. Anyway. What was my point with her? I don't remember. Anyway, she was like, well, yeah, obviously she just kept saying, just pay him the money because it'll be safer.
Yeah.
It just seemed like he expensed more money, or at least as much money, trying to gain $8 million. You know what I'm saying? Like, he had to pay him an extra million to go to do the trap. And in order to set the trap, he had to pay that Mexican dude and then the hotel. And then he had to pay his A team, which weren't very good, by the way.
I don't know. They were efficient until him.
Were they? I mean, were they, though? Like, okay, here's something
they
I want to talk
really
about.
They were really good
at killing. Okay.
Hans Gruber was just better. He did a better job. Hans Gruber.
The opening scenes of the movie is their first target, right? Yeah. Who is another dude who is part of this team.
Was that Johnny Nashville?
Oh, I don't know. Was it?
It looked like him.
Did it really?
Yeah, it was.
Was it?
That was Johnny Nashville. I didn't even think to.
Yeah, and I thought that this movie was going to be a comedy from the moment I saw him, and I thought, well.
Me too. Okay.
It's Johnny Knoxville. Same, right state, wrong city.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
No, it's fine. I was with you for a little bit. I'm like, Johnny Nashville? That sounds like a cool name.
Johnny Pigeon Forge.
We're going to go see Johnny Chattanooga in Memphis. I completely didn't realize that was him. And yes, this movie sets the tone real early with the dick joke right there at the beginning.
Oh, good Lord, yeah, yeah. So, and then it just deflates.
I'm surprised they didn't put a sound effect on it. But it just seemed like, it seems strange that if you have this sniper who's so good at getting to a place where he could snipe this dude, it would have been easier, I think. Like, the dude was asleep. Did you really need to wake him up, do the whole sexy, sexy pool thing, and then shoot him like 16 times? Wouldn't it have just been easier? Like, he's asleep. Just, she was there, right? With her waterproof lipstick that can somehow survive the pool. Like, while she was there, she should have just walked up and shot him in the head. Like, there was no point to doing all the other stuff to it other than to make it look, I guess, awesome or cinematic. It just seemed wasteful.
No, I agree. I agree in terms of wastefulness, but I enjoyed that group.
Well, I mean,
and the different personalities in that group made me laugh a few times in this movie.
And they're all weird tropes. Like there's no normal people in this movie except Vanessa Hutchins and, honestly, Mads Mikkelsen. They're like the only two normal people in this movie. And maybe the prostitute that he sleeps with later.
Yeah.
Like, that's it. They're the only normal people. And, I mean, even Mads and Vanessa Hutchinson's characters have, you know, issues. But they don't seem ridiculous. But that alpha team, whatever, they were the most ridiculous. Like, they just said, okay, you're each going to be a trope and then be the most ridiculous version of that trope.
Yeah, I'm okay with that. In this type of movie,
yeah.
I'm totally okay with it.
And you know what? You're right. I'm with you. I'm totally with you.
Put this in a James Bond film, and I'm deeply disappointed.
Yeah. Well, especially now, since we've seen James Bond movies where the Daniel Craig ones, where the bad guys aren't cartoon characters like they were in Pierce Brosnan and before.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But in terms of theme, have you guys ever seen Smoking Aces? Did we ever see that?
No, we haven't.
Yeah, I think so.
And I have not seen it.
We got to see that, because this movie reminds me a lot of it.
Isn't that a Guy Ritchie film?
Yeah, in terms of style and kind of having fun with the violence.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So one of these days we got to get to see that.
All right. But we do need to get some more Guy Ritchie movies on the list. I think I enjoy his directing.
Yeah. But this is not Guy Ritchie doing this. Who was the director on this one?
Of this movie? Yeah. It was a Swedish name. Jonas Åkerlund.
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 Which is...
How do you pronounce the A with the little circle over top?
You got it right.
Åkerlund? He's from Stockholm. Yeah. He is from Sweden.
Yeah.
He is known for such movies as this and something called Lords of Chaos. He did a U2 video. He did a Kesha, a Lady Gaga, Rammstein, Metallica, Pussy Riot, Beyonce. He's a video, music video guy.
Music video, okay. Yeah.
More Rammstein, Maroon 5.
I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
No, Michael Bay got his start there.
Well, not that there's anything wrong with that.
He has made some fine movies. You know what I'm saying? Like,
it's hard for me to like Michael Bay much anymore.
Why?
Because he killed the Transformers.
Okay, forget the Transformers for just a minute, right? Just forget that. Remember, 13 Hours? He did that. That was a good movie, and we all liked it.
Yeah.
And that was during his Transformers nightmare.
Remember Pearl Harbor?
Pearl Harbor is not a terrible movie.
It's a terrible movie.
If you take out the ridiculous three, the love scene, it's a pretty
you're
good...
You're saying if you change the movie, it's not a bad movie.
Yeah, it's a exactly. It's a pretty good historical film other than the love scene.
Okay.
No, you're it's easy to do some low-hanging fruit with him because he's got a lot of it. But we all like Bad Boys 1 and 2. We all liked The Rock.
The Rock, okay.
You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. So, yes.
Armageddon has decent moments.
Armageddon has some fun moments. Other than when you're putting animal crackers in people's belly buttons, it's a fine film.
Ew.
I know, right? We all know what goes in your belly button. Food should not be one of them.
Wait, that's not how it works?
No, that's not how you eat. You don't just insert and...
Osmosis.
Yeah,
or something. If you push hard enough, it goes in.
That sounds painful. That makes my belly button hurt.
Right?
Also what she said.
So my point is that... Or Sam's point was we should watch Smoking Aces. I think that was the point that you started.
Yes.
Okay, yep. I'm fine with that.
Basically, it's that style. It's the very kind of fun, hyper-violent. But this was based off of a comic book, right?
Yeah, Dark Horse comic, graphic novel, more appropriately called Polar.
Yeah. Yeah, so I can understand that, especially with the kind of crazy characters. I give a little bit leeway to that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I did not... I'm kind of with you there, Ope, with I did not believe Mr. Weird Blonde Albino Guy... he just didn't fit in this role. I don't know why people were taking him seriously. I just don't like that guy. And I don't know if it's because he's weird looking, but I have a hard time watching him on screen.
No, he is a weird looking dude. You're not wrong. I don't know what the comic book version of him looks like.
Yeah.
But yeah, he's all of his scenes made me uncomfortable. I mean, all of them. And
but then at one point I was thinking, is this a torture porn?
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
No, a little bit. It's kind of not like the Saw movies kind of a thing.
Yeah, it kept going and going on the torture scene. I was like, whoa.
Yeah, I don't know. Just all of the bad guys were weird and just over the top and very cartoonish. And if you're doing a comic book movie, I understand that they're trying to capture that. Mm-hmm. And from what I've been told, what I've heard about the people is that everyone, they love the movie except him.
Interesting.
Even the other weird bad guys, they're okay with because it's okay when you're the hitman team. It's okay to be kind of weird and whatever. Because we all liked them because they were strange and they had different skill sets and whatever. But when your main boss is that guy, it's like, how is he the boss?
Right.
You know, he doesn't seem like someone that could be the leader of that outfit, other than the fact that it was just because his dad gave it to him, I guess.
Yeah.
I don't feel like in today's society, I'm pretty sure that the main assassins would be like, I think Vivian would have stabbed him in the face by now. She seemed more together than he did.
Yeah.
So anyway.
Yeah, and I think we've talked about before in the past that in order to be a boss, other people have to fear you. And I don't see anybody fearing him.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, we've talked about that many times where, you're right, Andrew, where in the world of villains, right, in the villain community, usually the reason why you are the boss is because you are most feared. Crime families happen, you know, crime bosses happen because someone killed enough other people and rose to power, and enough other people swore, you know, legit, I can't talk tonight.
legitimate?
No, allegiance to that
allegiance.
Person.
Allegiance, yeah, okay.
And therefore, that's how you build armies and networking and whatever for villains. So, but you're not wrong. It's hard to imagine that dude as the center of any kind of villain thingy. So, I mean, I get Morgan Freeman at the beginning at the head of Wanted, because he seems like a creepy MF-er who's also smart and ruthless. You know, they don't all have to be huge and strong like Bane. I mean, you can have villains who are smart, and that's why they're in charge, is because they're really smart. But he didn't seem like any of those things. He just seemed like a dude that liked to torture Mads with some wire snips. So,
you know the crazy thing I just saw?
Hmm.
Our guy, Matt Lucas, the weird albino guy.
Yeah, yeah.
He was, you've seen the 25th anniversary of Les Mis, right?
I have.
The big concert?
Well, no, I haven't, but I thought you meant the movie. Yeah.
So. Oh. Anyway, he is the innkeeper in that.
Okay.
In that show.
Interesting.
So, in the 25th thing. So, apparently the man has a voice.
He's been in a bunch of Doctor Who.
Yeah. So I was just looking through his stuff to see if there was anything.
He was in Gallivant. Oh, I love it. He was.
Gallivant
he was,
is
he,
so good.
He was.
Andrew, did you ever see a Gallivant?
I did see some of it. I didn't see all of it.
You got to watch the whole thing.
I think season two got even better because they knew they weren't going to get another one. So they just threw it all in there.
Yeah. And they made fun of that. Even the intro song. Like, the king's like, sing me the song again. And he goes to start to sing the Gallivant song. And the crew is like, dude, you sung this song like 1,000 times. Let's sing a new song. I mean, they're making fun of that. It's great.
Yeah.
So, anyway. So, I think we had at least one, and I think two, and maybe three hopping men in this movie.
Oh, okay.
There were a few, yeah.
So, now, let me ask you this, and if you guys think the answer is yes, because I think the answer is yes, it's going to eliminate possibly all of the hopping men.
Okay.
Do we think there's going to be a sequel?
No.
I don't think so at all. I don't think it was that good of a movie to have a sequel. But then again... Well, Netflix doesn't care.
Worst movies have had sequels.
Yeah.
And I was looking to try to find if I could figure out if there was going to be a sequel. So if we assume that there's not going to be a sequel, then Hopping Man number one is Richard Dreyfuss.
Yep.
Does Duncan
that
go?
That was Richard Dreyfuss, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah. Like, they pulled him out of some cupboard, dusted him off to come in and be an old curmudgeon and say some funny things and leave. So does Duncan eventually go after him?
Well, he'd have to, I would think.
Don't you think? Like, don't you think, you know, he's going to remember the fact that he betrayed him? And so he's going to be pissed. So that's my Hopping Man number one. Hopping Man number two is the team of people that went to buy the company. Now the head of the company is dead. So are they going to come back?
The head of the company.
Yeah, yeah, you like get that? Are they going to come back? Are they going to still buy the company? Are they going to take over and be like, okay, well, this guy killed our company, so we're going to go after him? Is the reason why Vanessa Hudgens' parents were killed is because of that company? And then my third one is, and I just don't remember, did Vivian live? He shot her. She got shot in the back, but he leaves. I don't remember seeing her actually die.
Yeah, I don't know.
Because she seems like too cool of a character, like an actress, to bring in only to just give kind of one-liners and then leave. I mean, she was in Vikings. She can wield a sword and kick ass. And obviously having her... Having her answer the phone while she's in a female strip club was weird. Like, it just seemed... Like, do we have to do this? It just seemed strange, but whatever.
Well, by the way, thanks for the warning while I'm watching this at work. and not only that, I had somebody come knock on my door right in the cottage scene.
Mm.
And I'm like, holy crap. What am, you know, click, click, click. Get this off.
I mean, that's like a 2.5 minute sex scene between him and her.
Yeah, right?
And is it weird that my first thought was, oh, man, he's pushing her up against that glass. I bet you that glass is cold in her boobs. That's all I could think about. Because it's snowing outside. I bet you that's cold. Anyway. The cottage scene was great, though. and not just for that part. The rest of it, too, was pretty cool.
Yeah.
But again, totally unnecessary. Like, once they found out, like, they saw him. And they said, Cindy's in place. How did she know to go to that road? They didn't know where he lived. So how did she know to go to that road to do the breakdown? It just...
the lucky, luck of the draw, I guess.
I don't know. Just,
It kept the story moving, dude.
I know.
They cut the scene where they talked to a neighbor and interrogated and,
maybe,
you know.
Maybe.
Did all that.
Yeah, I will. I'd also say this. The people that were in the other places that he was renting to were just freaks. I mean, I felt like I was watching cut scenes from Seven.
Yeah.
Just freaks. That poor fat guy. They put like 4 into his chest, but he's so fat, like it doesn't kill him. And then he wakes up and starts cursing at him, and then they just friggin' unload on this guy. Just... so weird. They were all weird. That's what I'm saying. Everyone in this world is just the weirdest thing ever. Just
tropes. Don't you kind of have to be in that line of work?
I guess. But I mean, like that, like those other people weren't in that line of work. They were just freaks. They were just weird dudes. And the dude in Florida, I captured his audio. His voice weirded me out. I don't know why. His voice weirded me out.
The dude in Florida, which one was that?
He was the guy that opens the door and she's like, "Hi, I'm looking for 506. And he's like, "Oh, come on in." And then he slaps her and he's like, How do you like it rough? Like be beaten or slapped or up the ass? And then they come in and
kill
him.
That's right, yeah.
His voice didn't match. I mean, even the freaking doctor was just a weird looking dude. And the accountant, like, could we not find one normal human to be in this movie? Just these were just...
Well, isn't that a lot? What was the black and white movie with the red every now and then?
Sin City?
Isn't that kind of a Sin City thing?
Yeah, but that's like literally making a graphic novel physically move.
Okay.
Uh-huh. You know...
But isn't this kind of the idea?
No, well...
Only in color?
I guess. It just... That
glorious Technicolor.
That Technicolor, with surround sound, with Dolby Stereo. I don't know. I think that Sin City is way more of a stylized concept where we're trying to make this look physically like a graphic novel where people have like Mickey Rourke's features are exaggerated, maybe
exaggerated. Thank you.
And everyone is ridiculous, and blood splatter is ridiculous. I mean, it's all ridiculous. Whereas in this movie, I do like the fact that when we're introduced to people, we get the cool sound effects and like who they are. I like that intro kind of thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, like the movie stayed true throughout, so I appreciate that. I really do. I still had a good time with this movie. I'm not going to lie. I really, really had a good time.
I had decent time, but it was in spurts.
Yeah.
It was not a full experience.
Yeah.
Like Smoking Aces kept me going from the beginning to end in this type of style. I just had a hard time going back. I literally clapped when I saw the gloves. And the laser beams. I think I texted you guys.
You did. You said laser right hand saved the movie.
And that pretty much redeemed the movie for me. Because like, holy crap, something I've never seen before. This is awesome. Yeah. I want one.
But for paintball.
Oh, yeah. Not for outside your house.
Yeah.
Well, you know how my rule is. If something keeps my attention, it's generally a decent film.
Yeah.
And I'm right there with you, Sam. I couldn't focus the entire time. I mean, there was, like you said, there were some things that I wanted to focus on and that kept my attention, and then other stuff I just did not care about at all.
Yeah. Yeah, it just, I don't want to say it wasn't a smart movie, but it didn't require 100% attention.
Yeah, there is some fun dialogue in the movie, but you're not wrong. After we get past the opening scene with the sexy lady in the shooty part, then we spend a good 10 minutes telling you, beating you over the face that Mads is old.
Yeah.
He's got to go to the doctor. He's got to have a proctology exam. He's got to go to his accountant.
Oh, the sound effects, by the way, that proctology. Oh, yeah, good Lord.
It was pretty gross. It made me uncomfortable.
I never had one, but I can only guess it doesn't sound like that. I hope it doesn't sound
I don't know.
Like
I'm going to put earbuds in and not listen to what's happening. I don't want him talking about. And then, like, and there was.
I'm going to light a candle and put on some music.
Some Barry White. Here we go.
Bow.
Yeah, let's listen to some Endless Love. What? Two friends can listen to Endless Love in the dark. And I mean, so like, and then we have to, you know, he's living alone. He's got this kind of strange existence. We don't obviously know yet that there's a strange relationship between him and Vanessa Hudgens, that there's kind of a sense of protection that he has for her. And that's why he moved to BFE Montana.
And that did catch me off guard, and maybe because I wasn't paying that much of attention.
Yeah, I was.
But it really did catch me off guard.
Yeah, and we knew obviously that he was having dreams, nightmares, something from his past was bothering him, which is why he shot his poor dog. And he only had the dog. Like, he gets the dog, and I'm like, oh, John Wick dog. Oh no, he shot him. Shit. Wasn't expecting that.
Yeah.
And then he buys goldfish. I guess. I'm like, well, I guess it's harder to shoot goldfish. Going back to my point, like, people are weird. Even the lady at the convenience store was weird. I got some audio of her.
Yeah.
Oh, even she was just weirding me out the whole time she was talking. Anyway, I don't know. I just, the movie had its, I mean, when it was slow, this movie. I mean, like, falling asleep. But then you had really long action scenes. I mean, if you want to start the action scene in the cabin when he starts banging her, that scene goes on for about a good 7, 8, 10 minutes. I mean, that's pretty long for an action scene. One of the things I wrote was, did she kill some dude in a racquetball court? Because they're talking to Vivian, and there's some dude lying on the floor bleeding, trying to crawl his way out, and she's like, you good? Or something like that. I'm like, who is this person? And why are you killing people in racquetball courts? And then I said, what teacher approved the subject of him killing children? It was so strange, this little knife lesson as a teacher.
Yeah, they don't let you bring in knives to school.
No, not anymore.
Not anymore. I guess it's Montana. I don't know.
Maybe.
And then I wrote, well, at least he got some before stuff went down.
You think he knew all along?
Do what?
You think he knew all along?
Yes. Yeah.
I think so, too.
I think he did. Yeah. And I think he just figured, well, you know what? When they're going to spring their trap, there's nothing I can do about it, so I might as well just enjoy myself for a little while.
Why not?
Oof. Well, yeah. Like, it reminded me of, did you see the second 300 movie?
Yes.
The scene where...
in the boat?
Yeah. There's. You say, Andrew, you haven't seen it?
No.
There's a scene where Eva Green, we know her from Casino Royale and a lot of other movies where she gets naked.
Yeah.
And she invites the leader of the Greeks over to the boat. And she's like, hey, you know, we could be good together. Like, you should join me. And she starts, like, touching him. And then he basically grabs her and then he bangs her. Right. And the guards are outside, like, looking around, like, should we do something? Right. So then he finishes and she's like, so we're, you know, we have an agreement. He's like, no, I'm not going to join you. You're crazy. And she kicks him out because it was funny. It's like, well, I mean, if you're going to offer, I'm going to take advantage. And it just reminded me of that. It's like, well, you know, okay. I mean, whatever. If you're going to use it as a weapon, I'm going to take advantage. So, all right, there you go. And I did write Sam, wait, is that Richard Dreyfuss? Yes, it is. And then that's actually, yeah, that's kind of my, most of my notes. Tweedledee and Tweedledum is the bad guy. I still can't believe that. Poor Rusty, he has a dog. And I did write the dog weirds me out.
The dog weirds you out?
Yeah. The doctor, I mean. The doctor.
Oh, the doctor.
I did say dog. I meant to say dog.
Yeah, if I'm getting a proctology thing, I don't know if I want that much talking.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, let's just get it over with.
Just, you know.
Just, I don't know.
Yeah. All right.
Not on a date.
You ready for some clips of this movie, by the way?
Yes, sir.
All right, I actually captured a bunch because this movie had some really interesting things. Speaking of that that prostate exam, here you go.
When people ask me why I save the prostate exam till last, I just think it's nice. My patients have something fun to look forward to. And exhale. We're done.
If you listen carefully over the noise of my dryer, I don't know if you can hear it. You can hear some of the Foley work that's happening in his...
Oh, dear Lord.
During the exam, I want to know, for some reason, hearing the doctor talk without seeing him made me think that Dr. Becker, okay, what do we know him from? Do we know him from anything? He's done True Detective. He's in the Umbrella Academy.
Is he?
Yeah.
I finished that one up last week.
Yeah. He was Herb or Herb.
I don't know. Interesting.
It's Herb. I'm not a vegetable.
Yeah.
Oh, Richie Rich. But...
Nothing else I've seen. Oh, he's in that that TV series, the People of Earth TV series. He's Jeff the Gray. Anyway, whatever. Okay, here we go. Number two.
TV. Do you remember that TV?
Okay, so there's two voices happening, and I feel like that. So you have the clerk, and then you have the cashier lady, and then you have this other woman. And whoever is doing her voice, it sounds like a dude pretending to make a woman's voice, like a really bad version of a woman's voice. Okay, here you go.
TV series that I was telling you about? Mm-hmm. Okay, now you have to start it from the beginning. I got it in the box across the street. Now... It's British, but you can put the subtitles on.
Sounds kind of religious, though.
Well, it's not as religious as you might think.
Do you find Jesus attractive?
Oh, my Jesus is a handsome man, isn't he?
Oh, my gosh. That woman was ridiculous.
Weird.
Yeah. But that woman, she's talking to you. She's like, I don't know. It's just strange. I wrote expecting you. Oh, this is that dude in Florida. This voice, and this is... Now, I know she's supposed to be acting like she's a dumb blonde, but I know she's like, quote-unquote, acting in the scene, but there's just a lot of weird happening in this moment. Here you go.
Mm-hmm. Hi there. I'm looking for apartment 506.
What's it say on the door?
Sorry, I didn't see that.
Come in.
Great.
I've been expecting you.
It just, his voice just didn't sound right.
No.
It didn't sound like it fit that body. It just, that sounds like, again, someone else trying to be like a weird, you know, impersonation. Ah, okay. Here's the bit with the knife.
The kukri is an arterial weapon. Perfect for slicing through flesh. But it sucks at
stabbing.
There you go. Let's see what it can do.
Now I'm gonna rend poor Johnny in half. Here we go. This line made me laugh.
You know, I had the worst winter of my life one summer in Belarus.
What's going on, Porter?
It's just a funny line. Oh, Richard Dreyfuss. And here's another little bit of Richard Dreyfuss.
You trust Vivian?
No.
Her. I did.
I love that. I love that little noise he makes there at the end.
You trust Vivian? You trust Vivian?
I always liked that bit. And you know I had to capture at least a little bit of the weird boss man. So here's weird boss man.
Time to die, Herr Black Kaiser.
Nowhere to run this time.
Yeah. I think that if they had just replaced him and that character had been less of a cartoon, that that movie would have been a little more enjoyable.
Yeah, I don't know, maybe. I don't know. Yeah. Just every time he squirted stuff on his hands, it just made me uncomfortable. So, anyway. Yes. Boom. Okay. Yep.
And now for some more bad news. Ready?
I will tell you all of the trivia after I sneeze.
And bless you. Fuzzy bunnies.
Okay. Here we go. Oh, the one trope that I wrote is the I'm retired trope. There's about 20 more tropes. I just can't think of them right now. Like, and like all of the henchmen are all weird. I mean, okay, like that scene in the motel room, right? Like these guys are professional hitmen and they're all sharing this crap little motel room, and the redhead's in the thing banging the junkie, and then the big guy's like, I gotta poop, and so he just goes in there to poop. He's got the door open. Reading a magazine. I mean, it was just the weirdest thing. Just seemed weird. And then the girl, the Asian girl, was like dating the boss, and that relationship was weird. And anyway, all right. Trivia. There's not much trivia on this movie, honestly. There was only like four pieces, and I captured in half. Richard Dreyfuss personally directed several of the torture scenes, saying, "quote I wanted to make sure they were done right."
That's a little weird.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, could you imagine
Richard? Shouldn't do there, Rich.
yeah. But could you just imagine him going up to the director and be like, hey, I know you're the director of this film, but I'm going to teach you how to do this. But then again, all he does typically is, you know, music videos. released on Netflix in the U.S. within weeks of the theatrical release of another Mads Mikkelsen-led movie called Arctic, which happens to be titled Polar in some international territories. The two movies are unrelated. That's it.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Still try. Why did they call this one Polar? What's the reasoning?
I don't know. It's in the. It's from the thing.
Oh, that's the name of the comic book?
Of the graphic novel, yeah.
Okay.
So I don't know. I don't know if because the dude's bipolar. I don't know if it's because he always is cold. I just don't know.
Huh.
So
maybe because there's snow on the ground.
Maybe. I don't know. I said we'd have to. I'd have to look it up, and I'm not going to. At least not right now. Here we go.
Excuse me while I whip this out.
So we decided to do like weird villains. I mean, not just normal, typical villains, but just the dudes that are just a little weird, a little creepy, a little off. They're normal, see, whatever. So a lot of really interesting ways we can take this. We'll see what you guys did in comparison to each other. Andrew.
Okay. Number 3, Dr. Doom from Roger Rabbit, Who Framed Roger Rabbit.
Oh, that's a good one.
Oh, yeah.
He was quite a strange one.
Yeah, and Christopher Lloyd is always a great villain.
Absolutely. Number 2, Dr. Julia Harris from Horrible Bosses and Horrible Bosses 2.
Oh, is she the Jennifer Aniston character?
Yeah.
I've not seen most. I've only seen like half of the first one.
It's a great movie. And then number 1, Jean-Baptiste Emmanuel Zorg from The Fifth Element.
That's such a good one. Why did I think of that? I love that movie. It's like one of my favorite of all time. Oh my gosh, that's such a good one.
What a great bad guy too.
And that's way better than my number 1. I'm changing my number 1. Oh, that's such a good one. Okay, and Sam,
All right, I've got...
Andrew always comes up with better lists.
And no, see, I don't think my list is that good this week, but I've got to put... I can never get her name right. Gronk and Yzma.
Yzma. From Emperor's New... That's so Emperor's funny New you picked that. Yeah, okay. Because I did too.
And by the way, I saw a thing online today that said the Emperor's New Groove needs to be the next live action Disney. Yes. And there needs to be a llama with two people in it, you know. And one being the butt and one being the front.
Not a CGI llama, but like a puppetry thing.
Yeah, like puppetry. So I've got my number two, another great crazy villain in Hatcher of the Rundown.
Oh, that's a good one, too. Yeah.
Yeah. What? Not Christopher Lloyd. What?
Yeah.
What?
Oh, wrong what. Wait, what?
What?
I don't know what that's from. What is that from?
What?
I don't even remember what that's from, but okay.
And I finally was able to use this movie on a list of really crazy, stupid villains. The Tire from Rubber.
You know, I saw that on one of my Google searches, and I thought, "Yeah, whatever. It's just a dumb thing." Whatever.
So it helped me at least get to this point, okay. Or get one for this list. How about you, Sean? What you got?
No.
That is one big pile of shit.
There we go. Sorry. For some reason, I was looking for my Hatcher what, but I can't find it. This is bothering me. I don't know why I can't find it.
Why are you all doing this? I've given you.
You used to label things, but now.
I still label them. But I don't know why it's not in my. Oh, wait, what? No, that's Declan's speech. This is bothering me. Dang it. Sorry.
Oh, dear Lord. That's not it.
Terrifying. All right, whatever. I don't have it right now. Doesn't matter. What does matter is. So I did have, Gronk from, or Kronk from Emperor's New Groove. So I'm going to switch that one out with just the Joker from Dark Knight.
Okay.
The Dark Knight. See, mine aren't nearly as good as yours. I'm literally, like, I have that Fifth Element just sitting like 18 feet over there, or 18 feet, 8 feet away. And I should have looked at that and been like, oh, of course, that's a great one. My number two, I guess, is going to be Dennis Hopper's character from Waterworld.
Oh, nice. Okay. That's right. You are
not from Mario.
Not from Mario or any other movie where he's a bad guy. And my number one is going to be Immortan Joe from Fury Road.
Oh, nice.
Just because he's weird looking.
Or any of those, like, the King of Bullets and...
Yeah. The only other one I was actually thinking about doing was the Overdog from... The Space Hunter in the Forbidden Zone.
God, yeah.
Anyway. All right. Oh, that's it. That's our movie. And this is.
Excuse me while I whip this out.
I did not mean to play that.
Wait, what's supposed to happen?
That's what I meant to play. This is where we do our out of 10. You guys, we are going to rank this movie from 0 to 10, as tradition suggests. I will let Andrew go first.
I usually think this through ahead of time, and I have not given it thought. I just didn't like this movie. I mean, there was some decent action sometimes.
Yeah.
Both in the form of sexual action and physical violent action. But, that's about it. I just didn't enjoy it. Vanessa Hudgens, I didn't enjoy her as a character in this. I don't know. I'm going to give this a 4.7.
All right. That's fine. You like this just a smidge better than Kung Fu Yoga.
Yeah, I would say that.
Okay. Sam.
I think Andrew and I think pretty close alike on this one. Again, it didn't keep my full attention, only in parts and pieces. It felt like an homage to maybe a better director, but I don't know. It just the villain was too cartoony for me, even if it is a movie based on a I almost said podcast, on a comic book. I'm going to give it a 4.43 out of 10.
All right. That's fine. I'm looking at the... I'm actually Googling Polar, the graphic novel here. Polar depicts the story of international hitman Black Kaiser. He is forced out of retirement after an assassination attempt is made on his life. The story, described as bleak, features a femme fatale character and a large amount of gore and is set in an icy landscape. The webcomic is notable for its lack of dialogue and speech balloons and features somewhat minimalistic style and color, being rendered entirely stark black, white, and orange. Interesting. Huh. All right. Anyway, but cool. It's all done through Dark Horse Comics. So, all right, cool. That doesn't help my score at all. I'm just wanted to give you a little bit of background. I'm actually not going to give it much more praise than you guys. I had kind of a good time. Now, it might have helped. I had to break this movie up over 2 days. Or two viewings, I should say. Not 2 days, two viewings. I had to watch it earlier in the day, and then my family came home. So I definitely couldn't watch it while my kids were awake for fear of them just walking in and seeing what I was watching. So then I had to wait until after they went to bed to finish it. So that actually probably helped my viewing. Because I wasn't, you know, I could, there was basically after the scene at the cabin, I was able to turn it off. And that kind of helped, I think. So, and it's just kind of caught me in a good mood. I don't know. It made me laugh out loud several moments. So I'm going to give it, I mean, like when the guards are, like when he's storming the castle at the end and the guards are just leaving because they don't want to get killed. Like that just, I was laughing. That's just too funny. You know, he's like, go get him. And then they're like, F you, I'm out of here. And he pulls out some World War I pistol, which is weird. Anyway, which is the same, actually, if I think about it, it's the same weapon that Morgan Freeman pulls at the very end of Wanted. That's really strange. The German C9 or something.
Morgan Freeman.
It's the same weapon that they used as the platform for the Han Solo blaster. It's a little trivia.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm going to give it a... I gave Mowgli a 5. I liked Mowgli a little bit better than this. So I'm going to give this a 4.9. I like this one just a little bit better than Mowgli. I mean, I like Mowgli just a little bit better than this. So... Anyway, there you go. That's the movie. That's your show.
That's it.
Yeah. Go home.
What's next week?
Actually, you're probably already home. Next week, we're doing Outlaw King. It's our third in our series of Netflix movies.
Oh, yeah. That's the one that's got the Chris Pine wiener.
Yeah, there's going to be some Chris Pine wiener. Just going to give you a heads up. So, Sam, if you're watching this at work.
Thank you.
Yeah,
thank
you. There is a little bit of Chris Pine happening. A little Chris Pine. If you're not sure what this story is, if you've seen the movie Braveheart, the guy who Robert De Bruce, who betrays William Wallace, this is his story, how he becomes in power, becomes Robert De Bruce. So
that's kind of a funny name, isn't it? Robert De Bruce.
As opposed to Bruce the Shark, who is also a Robert or something, I don't know.
Of course, something like that.
Yeah. Are you going to do that accent?
He likes to cut off wieners and fry it, right? and then put it in, cut out the intestines in some certain sort.
Didn't even the villain in this movie do that whole bit about William Wallace?
Oh, when
he sure did.
They cooked off.
Pretty grotesque.
They cut off his cock.
Talked about cutting off his balls and his wiener and frying it over a fire.
Yeah, and then
it was nice and gross, isn't it?
Yeah, and then they spilled his intestines. You could smell what his intestines smelled like. Anyway.
That's what my cat's shit smelled like on a daily.
Oh, how is your little cat? I forgot you had a little cat.
No, we haven't seen the cat in a while.
Yeah.
Little bastard.
Has it calmed down?
A little. Yeah.
Little?
Yeah.
All right. Very good. All right. Well, next week we're looking forward to The Outlaw King. After that, I've got a couple more movies on slate. If there's something you want us to do, we did get a Twitter suggestion for Terminator. The original Terminator is on Amazon Prime. At least I think that's what he was referring to. I do know that.
Probably talking about Salvation.
Well, that one's on. I think that one's on Netflix, isn't it? Isn't
it? Yeah, it is.
Let's see. Terminator Genesis is not streaming anywhere. The original Terminator. Judgment Day is not streaming. The original. Salvation, yeah, Terminator Salvation is on Netflix. I can't find the original Terminator.
Huh.
Really, I just typed in just Terminator and 2, 3, 4, and 5 showed up, but I can't find the first one. Oh, there it is. There's the first one. Yeah, the first one is on Netflix.
Okay.
The 1984 one is on Netflix, so we can do that. We can do that after Outlaw King if you want. Like I said, since a listener actually suggested it.
Yeah, since the listener did it. Yeah, I'd say so. So
I'll add it to the list right now.
Perfect.
Yeah, so after Outlaw King, we'll do the Terminator. Thank you for that request. His name's Andrew. See how easy that is? No, just request it and we'll do it. In the meantime, you may go to our website. Maybe, I don't know, if you can. Can you? Can people go to our website, Sam?
No, not yet.
Okay. Still.
I mean, it's there, but it's just bad.
Still broken?
Just really bad.
You know where they can go is ncschoolheroes.com, and they can search Andrew Gibson and vote for me, and I could win $10,000. Shameless plug. But
say that again. What is it? NC?
ncschoolheroes.com.
School Heroes.
Oh, okay. That's cool. All right, yeah, vote for Andrew.
I'll have to take a look.
Yeah. And then
it ends March 31st.
All right.
How many times can you vote, Andrew?
On today. From many devices and many search engines. Web browsers.
Great. We'll do that. In the meantime, go to our Facebook page, facebook.com/cheapseatreviews, and you can like us and communicate with us. Same as Twitter, at cheapseatcast is how you can get a hold of us there. Email is cheapseatreviews@gmail.com. Feel free to shoot us an email if you want to. Leave us a review on iTunes, please. It really helps. It was brought to my attention that our live episode only had 45 minutes of the show on it. Hopefully that's been fixed. If not, I'll make sure it's fixed today. So on behalf of Sam and Andrew, this is Sean saying thank you for listening and good night.